Hello, my Nakamotachi, this is Joy News, here to give you a live update on the current events at Onigashima. This chapter essentially centers around one man, whilst you get some in-series confirmation for various speculations that the fanbase has held for quite some time. Today, we break down the journey of a certain character and follow the evolution of the swordsman from a determined child to a worthy king. The chapter began with Zoro's struggle with Enma, and this is just the beginning of a beautiful look at Zoro's relationship with his harem of swords. All of this and more on Joy News. But first up, let's go to weather.
Flame cloudy with the right side of crumbling.
Does she know what weather is? Anything else?
Black lightning!
You heard it here, folks. Black lightning. In other news, here in the newsroom, we've known for quite some time now about the existence of an intriguing Shimotsuki village in the East Blue. After Oda revealed to us in SBS Volume 96 that Kozaburo illegally left Wano 55 years ago and established the village where Zoro was from. Here is some archive footage of our on-site reporter who traveled to the East Blue last year after the release of SBS Volume 96.
So I'm here in the Shimotsuki village in the East Blue to find out more about Shimotsuki Kozaburo, the man who left Wano and founded this village. I'm here with a distant relative who will be able to tell us more about the legend himself.
Hello there. Hey. Hey, Ma. I'm on TV. I'm on the news. Hey there. I'm Shimotsuki Joyaburo. Kozaburo was my great uncle, three times removed. You may have heard of him. You know, two-time winner of the Suck Award, the Swordsmith Universal Cup. But yeah, he's my uncle. Everything you heard about him is true. The great samurai from Wano, Shimotsuki Kozaburo, the samurai from Wano.
Hey, don't say the geezer's name. The marines will come after us.
What do you mean? He named our village after his name. Makes no sense. We can't say his name. Makes no sense. He names the village after him. Now we can't say it. Why'd he do that if he was in hiding? Makes no sense. Damn old geezer. Despite his passing over 10 years ago, Kozaburo remains the talk of the town, with his relatives still proudly remembering his name. It is a wonder how Zoro still remains oblivious to this connection between his village and Wano, but for the One Piece fandom, this of course raises questions as to whether this has anything to do with Zoro's lineage and whether he is a Shimotsuki himself. This is Joycaster, reporting from the East Blue. Thank you to our archive team for digging up this footage. At least Zoro has now finally realized for himself the connections between his hometown and Wano. However, even after this chapter, Zoro's own heritage remains yet to be revealed. Comments made in previous chapters about the swordsman's resemblance to Shimotsuki Ryuma and Ushimaru did make it seem highly likely that Zoro may have some blood relation to the Shimotsuki family, but this chapter made this once again less clear with the flashback to the interaction between Zoro and Kozaburo. Whether Zoro is in fact a Shimotsuki or not doesn't seem important at this point. Blood and heritage doesn't seem relevant because given how connected Zoro's story is to the Shimotsuki family name, it seems that Zoro may as well be a Shimotsuki. But even if he was indeed a Shimotsuki, it seems this chapter perfectly set us up for a future moment where Zoro may go back on his words as a young child to not say Tsunachi, where he will actually use this exact phrase to surrender the name that he never knew was his and instead embrace building the name Roronoa that we have all come to know and love. This would certainly carry on the theme of making your own destiny in One Piece and be in line with what we know of Zoro's character. More on that after this commercial break.
Find your body on fire? Do you have wings but don't need them to fly? You just might be Lunarian. Ancestry.com can reveal your real Lunarianness even if you never knew it was there. With a simple DNA test, you can discover if you are Lunarian or one of the thousands of different types of almost as interesting species. Sign up now and save 56% on Ancestry.com right now and find out how fiery you really are.
Wow. King the Wildfire, what an inspiration. The only known surviving Lunarian. As much as this chapter was Zoro-focused, King has been really impressive. Even Shishi-san-san, one of Zoro's fastest, strongest attack, didn't have any effect on the commander. Apart from his great display in action, what really intrigues me is the way in which King has invited attacks. This panel in particular seemed as if King ran towards Zoro, only to stop right in front of the swordsman, exposing himself with his guard down, almost welcoming Zoro's attack. We were told that Lunarians are an extremely special race with high adaptability for survival, but what we have seen has suggested a very unique way that his body may possibly work, in that King absorbs the energy of his opponent's attacks to utilize it as his own, which may explain why he exploded after taking a stab straight to his stomach. The way in which fire appears and disappears from different parts of his body also raises some questions. But the question that is perhaps most pressing for the current match is what is King's weakness in order for Zoro to defeat him? This weakness may just be very well connected to how the Lunarian race was eradicated. But in other events, something which was explicitly confirmed in this chapter was that swords, great swords, each have distinct personalities, temperaments, and a will of their own which must be fulfilled. Clarifying our understanding of cursed swords, the flashback to Giza Kozaburo, who himself extremely resembles an older version of the personified form of his creation, the Wado Ichimonji, has made clear that contrary to previous understandings, the cursed blade is the outcome of when the needs of great bloodthirsty swords are not satisfied. And so this week, we have a very special guest, indeed, the chapter MVP. Hello, Enma. Thank you for joining us today. Is it Enma? Can I call you Enma? Or is it King, Lord of the Underworld?
Lord Enma is fine.
Lord Enma, thank you for joining us today. I understand that it's a very busy time for you right now, with you testing Zoro out to fight King.
Yes, it's a very exciting time for me. I haven't felt this thrilled since Odin.
Ah, yes, Lord Odin. It seems that after this chapter, we really have to give our props to the late Daimyo. We'd always thought that he was impressive, but to think that he'd been unleashing that immense amount of haki, truly an amazing feat.
That's what I want. More haki, more. But that boy Zoro, he's full of potential. When I think back to what we almost accomplished against Kaido with Odin, I revel in the thought of the glory that awaits Zoro and I once he figures out how to unleash my power. That poor boy thought that he needed to figure King out. All he needs to figure out is how to be worthy of my power.
It seems Lord Enma has returned to the battlefield. She really is quite the paradox, isn't she? As Lord Enma sucks out more haki, Zoro becomes better adept at exerting haki to show his strength. And of course, despite the name Lord of the Underworld, Enma will be the one to help Zoro soar to the top so that his name reaches the heavens. Exciting times ahead indeed. This chapter was everything we have wanted from a Zoro fight. Since the Straw Hat's entry to the new world, we had felt that Zoro hadn't been fully challenged, and this fight against King feels like it's the first time that Zoro is being really pushed to his limits and forcing him to reach the next level, which for him is learning how to connect with his swords. And with what we got in this chapter, he's certainly on the right track. The amount of haki emanating from Zoro in this chapter is reported to have even resulted in almost knocking out a One Piece YouTuber. Speaking of One Piece YouTubers, coming up next, we're going to the ever-eloquent, Zoro-loving fan to express his thoughts. Mr. Grandline Review, Joy News has always been very impressed with your consistent injections of One Piece culture straight into our YouTube feed, done so well in such an eloquent manner. We're sure you have a lot to say on this Zoro-filled chapter. Please, if you would oblige.
Me like chapter. Chapter good.
A man of many words. And whilst many had thought that it would take a long time before Zoro would learn how to coat his attacks with Conqueror's haki, you could even say that we are witnessing the making of a Conqueror right before our eyes. Well, I couldn't have said it better myself. This really was a great chapter, which not only highlighted Zoro's character and growth, but also his dynamic and relationships with other characters. The final panel was a perfect way to bring his journey full circle, reminding us of his promises which drive his ambition. It's funny that when Zoro first talked about his promise to Kuina to become the world's strongest swordsman, he had told Luffy that if the rubber boy ever got in his way, that Zoro would cut him down. Here, we see Zoro explicitly acknowledged his promise to Luffy to be of equal importance. This isn't something that fans needed to have been said because we have seen it through actions in the past, but it's certainly nice to see Zoro actually voicing it out. And of course, discussions about Zoro's character relationships would not be complete without the mention of Sanji. The Zoro-Sanji dynamic is something that Oda has been heavily focusing on in the recent chapters of the Onigashima arc, and one that the mangaka continued to subtly weave in this chapter. Not only are we seeing clear parallels such as the use of flashbacks to propel character developments for each character, but it seems that Oda is even breaking away from the usual structure of focusing on each character's respective fights separately to now showcase their struggle side by side. Here at Joy News, we've been saying for a while that the two fights may finish simultaneously, and it seems we actually may be seeing this given the current trajectory. Out of all of these dynamics and nuance, however, the greatest parallel is perhaps the shared determination of Zoro and Sanji in their roles as the respective wings of the future Pirate King. Just as we witnessed Sanji question what his utility to Luffy was in his recent struggle, Zoro in this chapter also reminds himself and the fans of his promise to Luffy. And with reports of only two chapters remaining for the year, the stakes rise as we wonder, where will the next chapter take us? After waiting for over 1,000 chapters, we finally got an extension of Zoro's backstory. Perhaps we'll be finding out about his mystery eye in another 1,000 chapters. Thank you all for tuning into Joy News, and please do subscribe if you would like to continue being updated on the events at Wano. You can also leave a comment below and even become a Patreon member if you'd like to support independent and reliable journalism. This is Joy News, and we'll see you again soon.